What do you think, buddy? I mean, I've never been around. It's been since like 2012, since people have been this excited about Skins draft.
Yeah, I mean, they did extraordinarily well. Their reviews are pretty outstanding. Their composite grade, there's someone who did like took 18 media grades, which is a fairly significant sample size. So even if your least favorite draft analyst is in there, he's canceled out by 17 others. And they had the highest quote-unquote GPA of any team, which is crazy. Mm-hmm. I think overall, I mean, I was texting with someone over there over the weekend and was like, look, it's going to come down to how Haskins is. If he's good, then this is going to be looked at as a great draft class. And if everyone else is good, but he's terrible, you're all going to get fired. So it's unfortunate that it is that way, but that's the reality of the league. But I've come around a little bit on Haskins since since the pick happened. My first reaction was like, oh boy, just because I knew that that pick was coming more from the ownership side than the football side. But in talking to some of the football people and kind of really getting their both on the record and off the record reaction to the pick and how they're approaching it, like I'm actually okay with it because they are now united on the back end of it. Even if they weren't pro Haskins necessarily going in, they're going, look, he's ours now and we're going to get every ounce out of him that we can. We believe that he can be good. It's maybe just not would have been the guy that we would have picked. And so the talent is there. He's got incredible arm talent. He's really smart. He's a really, really high-level student of the game, which I found out when I interviewed him this weekend. He started talking about Bill Walsh and West Coast concepts, and I was like, okay, that's not normal for a 21-year-old. And so I think there's a lot there. To get Sweat is amazing. I really like some of the picks, down ballot, if you will. So I think overall they had a terrific weekend.
And Craig, the Giants did the Redskins a huge favor by taking the Daniel Jones decision out of their hands by picking him at 6. A lot of people thought that was obviously a reach, thought that he might go at 17. Gettleman panicked, thought he had to pick him at 6 in order to secure him for the Giants. So they took that decision out of the Skins' hands. So that's kudos to the Giants for doing that.
Yeah, because then all of a sudden you would have had this drama of what, you know, who's going to win the power struggle. And that's right. That's the worst thing. And I mean, in Gettleman's defense, a phrase I will not say often because really there's not a lot of defending Dave Gettleman. If you've got a quarterback that you really like and you've got a chance to take him, just take him.
And that's what they did, exactly.
Yeah, and so like if they liked him that much, then you take him at 6. That said, liking Daniel Jones that much is good luck with that. But yeah, as far as the Redskins are concerned, it got to the point, too, where there weren't a lot of other players on the board. Brian Burns, I think, is the biggest decision you had to make there. There's a couple guys maybe that you're thinking about, but ultimately I think it comes down to Burns and Haskins. And even though pass rushers are really, really important, the fact that Sweat was still on the board, obviously, I think was a good sign for them, too. They probably felt like they could maybe get him because so many teams clearly did not have him on their board. So between those three guys, you take the quarterback if you like him, and clearly there's a large group of people over there that liked him, and the most important people that liked him.
So we know Dan Snyder wanted Haskins. Do you know for a fact, and I don't know if you can talk about this on the record, but did the football people have Haskins number 2 on their board behind Jones, or was it flip-flopped? Where was Haskins ranked on their board at quarterback?
I don't know where he wound up in the final rankings. I've talked to people that varied from I like other guys more, and that's the one, like specifically with Jay, I don't know. Like it was widely reported that Daniel Jones was his guy, but does that mean that Haskins was a close third? Because by the way, also Jay said on the at the podium Thursday night that Haskins was the number one quarterback on their board. That I'm fairly confident was not true. I'm fairly sure that Kyler Murray was the number one quarterback on their board, and he should have been. There's a reason he was the number one pick. But obviously, at the time of drafting, whether it was by Bruce or not, as a liaison to Dan, I don't know. But what I don't really know, and we'll find out in the coming weeks as I get the chance to do more and more catching up with people, is, okay, was it we didn't like him and they took him in spite of that, or we didn't like him as much as some of the other guys? And as long as it's the latter, then it's fine, ultimately, if they think they can work with him. I mean, that's the most important thing. Do you feel like there's something there to sculpt and something there to mold? And I can tell you to a man, everyone that I've talked to in the football operation after the pick, on and off the record, has said, yeah, we're excited to work with him. We think there's something there. And to me, like, that actually speaks really well of the organization, that there's not a bunch of bickering on the back end. People were making their arguments on the front end, some of which leaked into the media that probably shouldn't happen. But ultimately, as long as you're united on the back end, then you're straight, and that's where they're at.
And I think they clearly were. And look, I think in a lot of ways, and I said at the time, I think it was kind of a compromise pick, and that's fine, right? Because nobody's going to be unanimous. You had your guys that wanted to go edge rusher, that sort of thing. You had your guys that want to go quarterback, do whatever you could to get that need, and they did both. To me, what made that first round was the sweat pick. Now, I will admit, I know nothing about cardiomyopathy. I know nothing about 1.5 centimeters of heart thickness. I don't know anything about all that stuff. I'm assuming the Redskins did do some due diligence, although maybe I shouldn't give them that benefit of the doubt. What is the latest that you know about his heart condition or lack thereof?
So what he told us on the conference call is that in his final visit to the Houston Texans, he underwent more screenings, and he was cleared by their doctors. Obviously, whatever medical information the Redskins have, they have cleared him as well. They took a look at it. Every team does. Every team gets this stuff.
Because a lot of teams didn't.
Right. And I would guess they will continue to monitor it. I also talked to another team that flat out told me, like, we didn't have him on our board. We weren't going to do that. We think that the Rappaport report that it was a misdiagnosis was incorrect. And so I don't know what to make of it. Like, I don't have a great conclusion here other than I hope they continue to monitor it. I hope they continue to test, and I hope the young man's all right, because we're talking about, like, this isn't John Allen taking a risk on a shoulder condition. This is a kid's heart. And
yeah.
So I just hope that – I hope that it was a misdiagnosis, honestly, and that he gets to play football.
Of course.
And,
course.
You know,
does.
Oh, if it isn't, it's catastrophic. Sweat play, it's a catastrophe.
I think he's going to be fine.
Catastrophe. They traded up everything.
Is a stud.
Well, Haskins would have to be a five-time Pro Bowler to make up for it.
Without question.
What if Sweat can't play and Haskins turns out to be Jason Campbell?
F-minus.
F-minus. Yeah, he's got to be better than Jason Campbell. He just got to be. All right, so let's talk about some of the other guys. I fell in love with McLaurin just based on character from a buddy of mine who's a huge Ohio State fan. Then watching, of course, the viral video of him responding and just – you just see, like, what this kid is made of. I heard Urban Meyer raved about him more than any of his other prospects. This is how much he loved that kid. And then throw in the fact, oh, by the way, he runs.
Yeah, no, I'm a prospect crush on Terry McLaurin.
Yeah,
like, this
too.
Kid is the real – I mean, from the moment we got off the conference call with him, I was like, that was different. That was different than every other kid that we've talked to in my whatever number of years I've been doing this. And – he just has a maturity about him that's different, and it goes into his play, and that's kind of what I learned in doing more research about him after the fact, including a lot of what his teammates said, a lot of what Urban Meyer said. Ryan Day, his offensive coordinator, is now the head coach at Ohio State. They just love him because he's ultra competitive and just as selfless as he is competitive, and that is a rare combination, because a lot of guys want to win, but a lot of guys want to be the star while they win. Terry McLaurin wants to go play special teams and be a gunner. If that's what happens, if they win and he's inactive, he's happy.
Mm-hmm.
Like that's the kind of guy you want on your team. But when he gets his opportunity, he's going to go out and make the most of it. And whether that's as a wide receiver who can play slot inside, or he can play outside, he's a pretty precise route runner. His hands are a little questionable. That's why he's a third round pick. But ultimately, he's the best special teams player in this draft, who will play all four units of special teams for years for you. And so he is a really valuable guy, and he's a really good blocker. And for a run game that has been catastrophic at the wide receiver position blocking the last couple of years, basically meaning you can never be successful on any kind of outside run, that is a big deal, especially when he's not just a token blocker. He's a guy who's actually a receiving threat.